Thank you. reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter began to speak to the Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
from the entrance of the tomb. When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed, for you are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell the disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went and out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. And all that had been commanded them, they told briefly to those around Peter. And afterward, Jesus himself sent out through them from east to west the sacred and imperishable proclamation of eternal salvation. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
They'd been there in the garden as Joseph of Arimathea rolled the stone in front of the tomb's opening. They've been present in the final act of defeat, the reality of death. The women had stayed with Jesus and had come again on the third day to anoint the body that was by now decaying. They came to the tomb to perform the last act of faithfulness, and they found the tomb empty. They knew how to deal with death and disappointment. They'd been through that before. But how do you deal with the unforeseen, otherworldly reality of the empty tomb? Mark makes no excuses. In the end, they ran away in terror and amazement. In the end, their humanity grew. We see the best of our own humanity in the faithfulness of the women on Good Friday. We have to see ourselves, too, in their fear on Easter Day. We have to know, as much as we want to be faithful, we too have our points of failure. This is Mark's purpose in telling the story the way he does. Fear, terror, amazing. If we deny the fragility of our best intentions, we deny our humanity, and we deny something else, our need of a Savior, God's saving compassion. There's more than one story of resurrection in Mark's account. All through it, we see God acting as no one else could have acted. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" And they looked up and saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. They had wondered at an impossible need. God had acted. Each of us can remember times we thought something impossible was made possible. The time when forgiving the unforgivable came. The time when grieving finally became bearable. The time when a burden too heavy to bear became lighter. A stone had been rolled away. God's presence and action. A resurrection for each of the women, a resurrection for us. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. He said to them, "Do not be alarmed. He has been raised." A calming presence and assurance. While the women were not at once relieved, while they still didn't understand, someone was there. Comfort was offered. The angel's words of scripture they knew well, "Do not be afraid." The embodied presence of one greater than the emptiness of the moment. The assurance that someone greater is directing the course of the events. The promise of a greater story. Each of us can remember a time when we were desolate, perhaps without hope, overwhelmed with grief or worry or fear, and someone was there to hold our hand, offer assurance by their presence only, to stand in for God, as it were. A promise for each of the women and for us: you are not alone. Then the young man speaks again, "But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he's going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." Interesting. Tell his disciples, the ones who fled in the time of trial, the ones who had deserted him and hid in fear. Especially tell Peter, the one who had denied him, said he didn't even know him. He's in such pain. Tell them they will see him again, just as he promised they would, when they all swore they would be faithful to him. Jesus' promises are still good. And for us, for the times we've been unfaithful, does Jesus want to see us? He said he offered his body and his blood as a new covenant for forgiveness of sin and guilt, a resurrection. Our unfaithfulness is not the last word. We remember Jesus' words, "Drink you all of this, even the one who would hand him over. Drink you all of this. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for the forgiveness of sins." Go, tell his disciples and Peter. But they fled in terror and amazement, and they told no one what they were afraid of. In the end, even the women were seized by fear, by the frailties of their own humanity. But we know the end of the story told by others. All who loved Jesus were brought back into the fold, forgiven, restored in friendship and love, brought into the new life. In their being forgiven came their own willingness to forgive, to know what it is to love as Jesus loved. In this came their resurrection. The new life they found was more real than any they had imagined before, and they had believed they could not fail in their faithfulness, could not fall into their humanity. For unless we know and understand and accept that we cannot remain perfect, we cannot know truly the new life of being forgiven. Unless we know that we cannot save ourselves, we will not accept that salvation comes by God's action, and it is always offered and given freely. The women, the disciples, all Jesus' followers, Peter, before Jesus' death and resurrection, they could not understand the height, the depth, and the breadth of God's love for us. They couldn't understand until they had become desperate, empty of their own resources, until they found themselves in the darkness of human failure and inadequacy. They could not conceive and accept a miracle that would empower them to forgive others and themselves. The women came in grief. They fled in terror. The men had deserted and denied in fear. We miss the mark in our own ways. But in God's love, grief and terror and failure, anything that is the weakness of the world or of our humanity, is not the last word. The faithfulness of our Creator is the first and the last word, as it has been from the beginning of time, and as it was on that first Easter day and today. John Claypool describes it beautifully. "The worst things are never the last things, and the final sounds of history will not be taps, but revel." Alleluia. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen.
Page 358.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, a fragrant offering to God.
Thank you. pass the land, who will sacrifice for us, and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed it, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, guarding our voices with angels and mocking, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your
kindly affection one to another. And now unto God's gracious love and mercy we commit. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and give you peace, now and forever. Amen.